From the Time Center in New York City, City University Television, in association with the New York Times, presents a Times Talk series with editors and writers of the New York Times. Today's presentation, a conversation with Nick Kristoff, Times interviewer Carla Ann Robbins.
Hello, everyone, and good afternoon. I'm Carol Olson Day of the New York Times, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this exciting Times Talks. We're live at the Times Center in New York, and we're live around the world on the web. We're doing this special Times Talks and streaming it live today to take immediate advantage of having New York Times columnist and two-time Pulitzer Prize winner Nick Kristoff with us. He will talk about what he saw and experienced at the scene of the uprisings for democracy in the Middle East. Joining him in the conversation will be Times Deputy Editorial Page Editor, Carla Ann Robbins. As you know, Nick's reports from Egypt and Bahrain by Twitter and Facebook and on his nytimes.com blog were fast, furious, and gripping as he witnessed what he called lion-hearted men and women defying tear gas or bullets for the freedom that we take for granted. Please join me in welcoming New York Times Deputy Editorial Page Editor Carla Ann Robbins and New York Times op-ed columnist Nick Kristoff.
So, hi.
Howdy.
So, Nick, where you been?
It's, considering where I have been, it feels very comfortable to be right back here. So in terms of the Middle East, I started off flying to Cairo in the thick of it. I was actually at Davos at the World Economic Forum, and then watching the television screens of all these things happening and thinking, what am I doing, here? So flew into Cairo in one of these planes, which journalists are always familiar with, where basically everybody's trying to leave a place. So you're on a plane that is essentially empty, except for a bunch of people carrying huge cameras pretending to be tourists. So covered the Egyptian revolution, and then came back here briefly, and then went on to Bahrain to cover the events there. And which sort of had the same, very similar kind of feel to them, except a different ending so far. And then back to Egypt, and now I'm just plotting my next move.
You'll tell us about it before you go, though.
I'm a little worried about tipping off the places I'm planning to go, but I don't know if they watch, but.
I'm sure they do. So two trips to Egypt in the last few weeks. How different is it now? Because, in the news right now, we're seeing that the army went in and cleared Tahrir Square of protesters today. There's a big fight between Coptics and Muslims. Does it feel freer there? Are people getting nervous that the military is going to stay too long at the party? How much has it changed from your first trip to the second one?
It's a really interesting question. It kind of changes day to day. And I think I might have answered that differently, say, a week or 10 days ago than I would right now. At one level, there's certainly more freedom. I mean, people really do feel that state security isn't watching over them so much. They feel freer to protest. On the other hand, there have been these signals that the military essentially wants to, they're willing to get rid of Mubarak. They're not willing to get rid of the system. And my hunch at the end of the day is that although a lot of Americans, I think, have been fearful that Egypt will be completely upended and that there will be a lot more change that they would like, that it may well be that we will look back and think that Egypt had less change than was optimal rather than more change than was optimal. My hunch is, the candidate that everybody talks about for president is Amr Moussa, the former foreign minister who...
Head of the Arab League,
who's, very much been part of the system. And the way Tahrir Square was cleared today, I don't know if you've seen some of the video there. The army and plainclothes guys went in with a lot of brutality, pulled out these tents, beat people, and it really looked a lot like the Mubarak thugs going into Tahrir Square a month ago. And the on Twitter, you could certainly sense that feeling of despair that, you know, we had a revolution and these guys didn't hear about it.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about Twitter and about what it was like covering it. You were, of course, a great aficionado of tweeting, but you also use Twitter for reporting. How important is, you know, we hear so much about the importance of the internet and Twitter and all the social media for these revolutions. Was it important in Egypt, less important in Bahrain, more important in Bahrain, and are we overdoing this, or is this really the fundamental change in politics in the Middle East? Is it being driven by the internet?
I think it'd be a little much to say it's driven by the internet, because it's driven by a lot of factors. It's driven by demographics, it's driven by economic problems. But there have obviously been revolutions, you know, throughout history. On the other hand, I do think that the internet and the social media change the equation in a couple of different ways. I think they made a lot of young people aware that other people felt the same way, and so a lot of people who were mildly discontented suddenly realized that all over the country there are people who share this real anger toward the regime. They, to some degree, made it easier to organize, although it hasn't always worked out that way. Sudan put out a Facebook notice about a demonstration in Khartoum, and then when people showed up for the demonstration, arrested them all. So it does cut both ways. I think that, you know, one of the problems for regimes when they're faced by this kind of an uprising is the, you know, calculating the costs of repression. And I think that having a lot of cell phone cameras around and having the ability to upload them to YouTube, to put the great Facebook websites, basically raise the costs of repression. And probably Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya, the Arabic language satellite broadcasts, that, you know, they were as important in that as anything, and probably as important a factor in the viral nature of these revolutions as were Facebook and Twitter.
Yeah, I felt watching it from here that it was sort of an extraordinary misstep when they shut down communications, that it made it seem so much. I think people in the times that I've worked in Egypt, that people, it always felt less claustrophobic there than a lot of places. And while it as repressive as it was, there were a certain amount of tolerance of it. But there seemed to be a huge amount of freedom suddenly with Twitter, and people were having the courage to get up, although you can also tweet and it's not your own name. And the government's reaction to suddenly shut that down and to shut cell phones down and to shut everything down at once, it looked like an incredible moment of weakness rather than strength. Did that feel when you were there that was a major turning point? Because it looked that way from here.
Yeah, I mean, the government, I think, in Egypt was sort of discombobulated in its response. And one of the problems with autocratic regimes generally is that they use propaganda to deceive the people. But at some point, it becomes pretty hard to, you know, people just, they know that it's all propaganda. But the real effect of propaganda often is that it fools the people issuing it.
Right.
And so they think, oh, the people really love me. And so I think that in the case of Egypt and to some degree Bahrain and Libya, you all had governments that were to some degree delusional about and just believed their own propaganda a little bit too much. And so I think that the closure of the internet did indeed come across to some degree as desperate, and it was so late in the game that it didn't really undermine things too much. It did change the reporting, because in Bahrain, we kept shooting videos, and then it just became so difficult to actually get it out, and to, you know, to get out emails, to get out stories. It really complicated the reporting. I don't think it vastly complicated the process of organizing a revolution.
And, you know, we've gotten from Twitter people asking questions about Twitter, of course. One of the interesting questions was someone sent in and said, is it possible to report objectively from in the middle of a revolution? I mean, you've obviously covered many moments like this, but
you know, I think that's generally a problem with reporting, that it's very easy to get caught up in the excitement of things. It's maybe less of a problem for a columnist, because I'm supposed to be opinionated. I remember in China in 1989 covering Tiananmen, and on the one hand, you had a bunch of students who had this sort of Statue of Liberty imitation called the Goddess of Democracy. On the other hand, you had an army shooting them. And it's really hard in that environment as a journalist to, you know, try to stay neutral in some ways. And what does that mean, especially when your friends are being arrested? And the same was true in many ways in Egypt and Bahrain. I just really admired the people out there. There was one day in Tahrir Square when the Mubarak thugs were attacking, and I was inside the square. These Mubarak thugs, who were essentially the police, were firing volleys of bricks and rocks and beating people. They had these clubs that with nails embedded in them. It was like Central Casting's version of a thug. And I was in the little field hospital inside the square, and there was a carpenter who had been hospitalized 7 times in 24 hours. He had one arm in a sling and one leg in a cast, and he was being stitched up, and then he was going to hobble back out to do battle. I just thought, this is just the acme of human resilience. And I was so moved, and I step back to take his picture, and I bump into a guy in a wheelchair. He was a double amputee, and he had rolled his wheelchair into Tahrir Square to do battle, and he was being treated for, I think, a head wound. And it just, you know, in that kind of situation, how can you not just be so moved and take sides to some degree? What I really try to do, I mean, I confess that I do take sides. What I really try to avoid.
What we pay you to do, actually.
That's right. Yeah. It's nice to be paid to take sides.
In a considered way, of course.
But there's a secondary danger that then you tend to believe one side more than the other. And one of the things I've learned over the years is that victims actually lie just about as much as perpetrators. And it's a, you know, instinctively you kind of want to feel for the little guy, but the problem is that little guys, when they're being shot, they tend to exaggerate things as well. And you have to be as skeptical of these utterly heroic people being shot as you are of the government shooting them. And it's something I've learned, you know, by trial and error to some degree the hard way. And that's very counterintuitive when you're in that situation.
One more sort of technical reporting question on something like this that people want. How do you use Twitter and other social media for covering something like this, particularly on this issue of how do you know what's true and what's not true in this information? I know that for me, following this, one of the first things I was following on Twitter was you, because I knew I could trust you and what you were out there tweeting. It was Nick Kristof of the New York Times, of course, doing it. It seems like a fantastic potential, what we call lead source, and it sort of points you in the right direction. But there's also an enormous amount of information coming in, and how do you know what to use and what not to use?
I try to tweet what I see. And so that I have full confidence in. The problem I always have is that I get people who are tweeting things, and I don't know whether to retweet them. And I remember at one point, you know, this early on, I think in Cairo, this came up, and somebody who I'd been following, who seemed vaguely credible, but I didn't really know the, you know, what kind of reporting they did. They reported that there was live fire somewhere in Cairo, that the police were shooting. Open fire on a bunch of demonstrators. And, you know, I thought, should I RT it? Should I retweet it? And I decided not to, because I felt that would kind of put my imprimatur on them, and I didn't know their standards. And it turned out that it was rubber bullets, not real ammunition.
Although so rubber bullets can be pretty awful.
Can be pretty awful. But I was glad that I hadn't, but it did also feel that if I only tweet things that I see, then I'm being kind of left out of the game. I mean, that other people are getting all these tweets about things, and I'm just not part of that conversation. So at times, what I try to do is, you know, tweet that, you know, there are, you know, some people are saying X, I can't confirm it. Or, you know, anybody know if there is something to the reports that X.
How often do you do that? How often do you send out a question and hope that people will be able to give you answers?
Periodically, and sometimes it really helps. I'm thinking about a trip to Mauritania, which has had demonstrations, but they've essentially gone uncovered because there are no reporters there. I Googled Mauritania to see what news there was of the protests there, and essentially there was none. But I knew that there had been protests, so I tweeted a question, you know, are the protests still ongoing? Are they being violently crushed? Are they being tolerated? And that through that got connected to a Mauritanian who has a wealth of information and turned out to be really, really useful. So at times that has been very helpful. But you also tend to get a lot of junk coming into.
Can you talk a little bit about the role of women in Egypt and in Bahrain in these protests? You've written a book, obviously, about women around the world. It's at the same time it's the Middle East and places I worked, like Saudi Arabia, women can't even drive. So Egypt has obviously a lot more freedom, and so does Bahrain, but not really in the political space.
Yeah, I was pleasantly surprised both in Egypt and in Bahrain, and I think really the same has been true in a lot of a lot of these revolutions, the degree to which women were involved, young women. And I think that it may have been intuitive for Westerners to think that those women who get involved are essentially the more secular, more liberal, more educated types. And that is true to some degree, but I got to say there are an awful lot of conservative women with heads covered who have very conservative views, who are in favor of Sharia law, who are also out protesting and who are just really indignant at corruption, at Muslim Brotherhood, you know, brothers who were arrested. And depending on country by country, they had different, some places they marched with the men, other times differently, but they were not just at the back of the crowd, they were not secondary, and they showed unbelievable courage in Cairo. There was one day when I was trying to interview the pro-Mubarak thugs. I thought I should try to.
You mean the guys with the sticks and the nails?
The guys with the clubs.
Did you make them put the clubs down first before you talk to them?
Well, as as any reporter knows, it's kind of astonishing the degree to which you can actually interview murderous goons if you walk up to them and say, "Hi, I'm a reporter, and I'd like to know what you think." The problem is it doesn't always work.
Yeah, and less now than it used to, unfortunately.
That's absolutely true. But I was trying this approach, and so I walked out with a video camera, and there were these, two Egyptian women who were trying to walk to the square to join the protest, but they had come in the wrong entrance, so they were being waylaid.
Right, and the entrances were very narrow, and they were quite controlled.
That's right, and essentially there were several entrances where you could enter, but they came in the goon entrance. And
goons
these two
must
sisters.
Wash their hands before they enter. Yes.
And the goons saw them and were harassing them, shouting at them, and they were just very reasonable to listening them out. And then I tried to interview them, and so then the goons kind of swarmed me, and then they made their escape. And so then I found them again, and one of the goons was sharpening his straight razor. Well, I was trying to interview these two women, and I was just blown away by their poise and by their courage. And you saw that in Bahrain too. There were a lot of after the army opened fire on the protesters the next day, you had a bunch of women in that same protest marching right to the same place where the troops had opened fire, and
people bringing their families in Bahrain when they camped out overnight, an extraordinary thing. I mean, I can see, I don't know, as a mother, I just sort of bringing a small child into that, it just shows you the passion people have for it. Or were they more naive in Bahrain? They didn't think the government would do worse to them?
I think that the people who brought their children in, and I saw the same in Tahrir to some degree, I think they were naive. I don't think they really expected there to be the kind of violence that did unfold. But there were a lot of kids there, babies. People spent the night in Bahrain, there in Lulu, in the Pearl Square. And I wrote about a doctor who'd been clubbed, and he was actually trying to, there was a small infant on the ground that he was trying to help when he was attacked and when he was clubbed. I guess one of the questions is, and one of the things I tried to ask a lot of women in these countries is a more democratic Egypt, more democratic Bahrain, is a more democratic Middle East going to be less hospitable to women's rights? And
be less hospitable.
Less hospitable. And if you ask Egyptians, for example, should a woman be allowed to be president? 25% say yes. I mean, a lot of Egyptians think, it's inappropriate for women to be leaders. And in a number of these countries, you've had leaders who are sort of secular, modernizing, pro-Western, who are probably ahead of their populations in terms of women's rights. And yet, so I would go up to these women in these protests and say, if you win, are women's rights going to be set back? Because it's going to be a little like Iran in 1979. And they were so vociferous about how that was not the case and how a more democratic country would, in the end, have to respect women. And they were out here trying to overthrow the dictator, and they would be out here trying to overthrow any men who tried to restrict them, that ultimately I just kind of retreated with my tail between my legs after a lot of these interviews.
Did they change your mind, though?
Yeah, I think that they did to some degree. I mean, I think that there may be some elements where perhaps women, some elements of family law, for example, maybe FGM in Egypt may be something that has more popular support. So maybe you would have an elected president, an elected government, not try to push at it. But in general, I think that the women convinced me that a more democratic country is going to be good for women as well as men. In most cases, I mean, democracies, as you know, democratic movements are really unpredictable, and bad things can happen. And if you get a half dozen countries that overthrow their dictators, maybe one or two will be a Yugoslavia, or the bad things can happen. But overall, I was very hardened by the trend.
We want to get onto Libya, obviously, but one of the questions that was also asked about women's rights is whether the United States should be pushing to improve the rights of women in the region as part of this transition. But I suppose I wanted to put that in the context of a bigger question, which is, there are going to be elections in Egypt. How much progress is being made? What sort of influence can we have to make sure that this turns into something closer to a real democracy? A lot of people died to get to this point. My fear is that it's somehow going to get snatched away again. And as an editorial writer myself, I'm very interested in what the United States can do to make sure that all of the rights of the Egyptian people, the people, particularly the people who risk their lives, that it just doesn't turn out to be more of the same.
I guess I would say that, in general, one of the risks for America and for other countries, the international community, is that we're going to focus on elections as just the index of whether democracy has come. And I think that,
I mean, it's necessary, it's not sufficient.
Yes, exactly. And that maybe we should, that while obviously there need to be elections, and I think that there will be, we also have to be just scrutinized just as carefully the progress toward a more civil society and freedom of the press, for example. Make sure that people who criticize the army in Egypt, for example, don't get disappeared. Well, in all these countries, disappear is a transitive verb. And I think that we can, that is a role that we can usefully play to push these governments to honor do a little bit more, to be a little bit more open in terms of accountability. And that applies to women as well. I don't think that it tends to be very productive if the United States stands up and says women should, you know, should have this right or that right. I think that we can support women from within the country, within the culture, who or men for that matter, who advocate women's rights. And in Afghanistan, for example, I think that we're just an awful lot more effective when we support Afghan organizations or Afghan imams who support girls' education rather than us announcing it. And maybe it seems to me the best example of this has to do with female genital mutilation, where since the 1970s you had this big international campaign, UN-led campaign all around the world to, you know, say that, well, what had been called female circumcision was mutilation, was should be laws passed against it. And this campaign essentially had zero impact. And in contrast, though, you had some local grassroots organizations in some countries, including Egypt, that have done spectacular work from the grassroots. And these are groups, you know, led by Muslim women, or in some cases men, and they are bringing about change. And I think that we would be so much more effective if we tried to bring about that kind of cultural change and advancement of women's rights by supporting those groups and giving them the megaphone rather than trying to do that from outside.
So did you see, and I don't want to solely focus on Egypt, but did you see progress toward elections? Or are they organizing the terms of who can participate, how the press will, you know, give access to opposition members? Is there progress there?
Yeah, there does seem to be real progress. They are talking about dates for parliamentary and presidential elections. And there was some danger that if it was going to be held right away, that there wouldn't be time to organize them. I think that they're going to end up with enough time that there will be realistic elections. I do, my hunch is that the government, that the system will control things to some degree and try to dampen outside voices so that it's not going to be a election that we would expect in Europe, for example, but it'll look a little more like a, you know, maybe a Mexican-style democracy, and that there will be real competition, but you will also have institutions that do, to some degree, control the debate, control the outcome.
And the army will continue to control the
and
economy.
And the army, yeah, I mean, the army, I think, is just, the army, I think, really wants to ensure that its leaders get their way of life, their standard of living, and all the money that they make through their businesses. And you know, that is, I think, one reason why Amr Moussa is most likely to emerge as the first president, at least initially. You know, maybe down the road it'll evolve.
Because he has two things. One is he has a certain measure of charisma. Apparently people like him in the street, and he's already made his, cut his deal with the army.
Yeah, I think that people like him on the street, partly because Mubarak did not like him.
Right.
And he also, I think, from the army's point of view, he kind of comes from the system. And I don't think they see him as a threat. Al-Baradei, everybody in the U.S. was talking about Al-Baradei. In Cairo, just nobody talked about him except to complain that he didn't really feel like a real Egyptian.
Well, he spent most of his life at the in Vienna at the IAEA.
That's right.
Yeah. Libya, which is, and some of the questions are about, you know, what were you hearing when you were just there last week about Libya and what they expect to happen and what the United States should or shouldn't do and what the responsibility of Egypt is in this? I mean, how much talk was there? Certainly the Libyans were inspired by Egypt and Tunisia. Now back in Egypt, are they talking about Libya?
One of the really fascinating things to watch was exactly that, that the change, and that traditionally in the Arab world you had this kind of sort of dictators club, and each dictatorship would support the other dictators, and the peer pressure was not to give in to the public. And now you do feel that changing. And
although Gaddafi was trying to whack a whole bunch of people, including
so. Although not for not for being democratic, but
yes.
But in Egypt in particular, there was this just huge support for Bahrainis and also for Libyans. And it was really just mind-boggling to see all these Egyptians who were then organizing convoys of aid, and doctors were volunteering to go out to eastern Libya to provide services to the Libyan rebels, and at considerable risk. Then the Egyptian army was initially blocking them from going at the border. It was letting journalists through, but blocking Egyptians, and then they just eventually prevailed. It became clear that the mood in Egypt was so much in favor of a democracy movement in Egypt and, frankly, elsewhere in the Arab world as well, that the army, to some degree, bowed to that. And I think that the fact that Amr Moussa is, in effect, in favor of a no-fly zone.
We believe. I mean, he's been reported to be in favor of
it. We think, yeah. That reflects his own calculation of where the public opinion is in Egypt. And so I, one hopes that there is going to be a broader shift, and that as politics becomes more democratic, that instead of seeing excuses for tyrants, we're going to see real pressure on them, and it'll be an awful lot more effective when you have other Arab countries complaining about human rights abuses than when you have the State Department doing that.
The Obama administration, which has done, as we say in our lead editorial today, a considerable amount of hand-wringing about Libya and a lot of back-and-forthing, all options are on the table, but no-fly zone is too hard. I mean, we've heard lots of back-and-forthing from them in the last week and a half, which I think blunts the impact when you do make the threat to then back away from it. One of the things that they're saying today is that they want a Security Council resolution. I'm not sure they can get it before they impose a no-fly zone. Certainly, there's a lot of talk also that has to be some buy-in from the Muslim world. There's going to be the Gulf Cooperation Council, the GCC, has already called for it, for a no-fly zone, the Security Council demanded that they do it. They obviously can't get too involved. Do you think the Arab League is going to do it under Moussa, that they'll endorse it this Saturday? And do you think that Egypt would be willing to participate, should participate, needs to participate? And you have endorsed the idea of a no-fly zone in your column. I know that. So,
yeah, I have. I mean, I think it would be really helpful if Egypt and Tunisia joined the effort. I think that it is quite plausible that Egypt will. I'm less clear about the politics of Tunisia. I think they would probably want to, that if they think that Gaddafi is out, they'd be willing to join the effort. If they think he might hang on, then they might not. And I don't know how they see that issue. Likewise, I guess I would bet that the Arab League will endorse a no-fly zone, but I wouldn't give odds. I just don't know. But I think that the Gulf Cooperation Council and Egypt together would give us some real cover to impose a no-fly zone, and I think and also Europe would to some degree join in. And the problem is on the Security Council is obviously Russia and China.
The Chinese seem to be not as clear that they're as negative about it. The Russians have been much more explicitly negative, which seemed surprising.
I think, yeah, I mean, I think China is concerned about which way the outcome will be, and if, is Gaddafi going to survive or not.
The Chinese said today that the issue was anything that would ensure a quick return to stability, which is about as classic a Chinese statement as you could possibly ever get. Talk a little bit about a no-fly zone. Would it make a difference, do you think? Is it more the symbolism of it? Will it stop people from being killed? Does it tip the balance? I mean, one of the questions, of course, is how long you have to do it. I mean,
right.
The United States, France, and Britain did it, and it certainly saved who knows how many people in Kurds and Shiites in Iraq by flying that cap. But they flew that cap from 1991 to 2003 till the invasion. If Gaddafi holds on, are we committing forever? I mean, talk about the logic, both the military and the political logic of it.
Well, the reason I'm in favor is, and this is somebody who, of course, opposed the Iraq invasion, was against the surge in Afghanistan.
But had called for a no-fly zone in Sudan.
In Sudan, that's
yes.
Right. That's right.
I follow.
For somewhat similar reasons, the UN has endorsed the notion of a responsibility to protect when a leader attacks their people. And it seems to me that there's not only a humanitarian element here, but also that it would just be a catastrophe if Gaddafi, after wobbling so much, managed to get back into power. And at the end of the day, we're not going to convince Gaddafi to give up. And air power is, it's an element in the way Gaddafi has managed to, his forces have managed to have something of a resurgence, both in terms of their ability to hit the rebels in the east, but also in their ability to transport things. But I think, to me at least, just the most critical element is the ability to send a signal to try to peel off military officers from Gaddafi. And I've just been spending a fair amount of time on the phone talking to people in Tripoli, including some with military connections. And I think, I just have the sense that there are a lot of people who are wavering and they want to be on the side that wins. And early on you saw all these defections from the Gaddafi government, I think because they thought he was going down. And those have slowed down because I think they think, well, maybe he'll hang on. And I think that we, you know, the really important thing about a no-fly zone is that it would signal international resolve to push Gaddafi out, and that that would change the calculations of some of these people. I just spoke earlier today on the phone to a friend in Tripoli who was very, very cautious in a way that he had not been, and I think he was very concerned about who was listening on the phone line, and I think he felt that in the Tripoli area, the tide had shifted, and he was really scared in a way that he had not been. And you know, it's not only a question of a no-fly zone, but we can also jam the Libyan state television, for example, and state radio, and hamper their ability to send out that propaganda.
And military communications, which we have been hearing for more than a week that they could do and were thinking about doing. I'm not sure why they haven't done it.
I don't know. My hunch is that the military communications probably matter a little bit less, because I think, you know, the planes are essentially given orders to go out, and if you see something, then shoot it and then come back. So it would matter, but probably the critical element would be
It would spook people. It would spook military people.
That
if you're talking about the psychological impact.
That's definitely true. And it would also, there are some of these bases and airfields and units scattered around the country, and if they all of a sudden, military communications go out, if state television goes out, then I think that does, if you're a base command, I was in touch for a while when things were teetering a little more with somebody, a senior officer at one base in Libya, and I think that person was in touch partly because they sense that things were going toward the rebels, and I think that I'm no longer hearing from that individual because, again, they think Gaddafi is stronger now. But I think that would be a really good way of sending these messages. And I think that Bob Gates has, to some degree, exaggerated how difficult it is to impose a no-fly zone. Just talking to people in the Air Force who were involved in administering the Iraq no-fly zones and the Adriatic no-fly zones, they think that this, by comparison, especially over eastern Libya, would truly be something of a piece of cake. And especially if you didn't do it over Tripoli, if you don't do it over areas that Gaddafi controls, but over eastern Libya where he doesn't control, that then the issue of taking out air defense systems doesn't arise. They also noted that in the case of the Iraqi no-fly zone, we did not systematically, we ran that for 10 years, as you say, and we did not eradicate their air defense system before doing that. We would periodically, when they would paint our fighter aircraft, we would destroy it, but we did not try to preemptively take out their air defense systems.
The way you would if you were planning on invading or starting an air war.
Correct.
You'd go in and they would just. So what do you think the hesitancy is here? I mean, I hear from a lot of people who say, well, we're already doing Iraq, we're already doing Afghanistan, there's just so much that we can do, and getting involved in another Muslim country which has oil, even if you've got the endorsement of the GCC, even if you potentially have the endorsement of the Arab League, it's going to look like one more oil grab by the United States. No, it's not my opinion, but yeah. There are a lot of people who feel that way because that's just, they're so used to having Arab leaders say privately they want the United States to act, and then turning around and denouncing us in public. I mean, is it dangerous for the United States, or is it conversely dangerous for the United States to stand by and not do anything?
There's one senior Air Force person said something that I thought was interesting. He said that after Vietnam, of course, the U.S. military had this, or the U.S. as a country had this sort of Vietnam syndrome. We were very reluctant to deploy assets because Vietnam had been such a disaster. And then in Bosnia, for example, you know, we finally were nudged into acting, but it took too long. And he thinks that Iraq and Afghanistan have been so much more difficult than people had expected, and just, again, create something of an Iraq-Afghanistan syndrome such that we're, again, you know, very hesitant. And, I mean, some hesitation is absolutely wise. But that is part of what is going on. I think that in the case of the White House also, they think that they've tried to make a virtue of their passivity and have been trying to take credit for the idea. I mean, it is true to some degree that Egypt's revolution, because the White House was waffling the whole way along, that Egypt's revolution in the end was a little more authentic because the White House didn't really come out against Mubarak until the very, very end. And so there, this notion that revolution will succeed if it's organic and if the U.S. doesn't intervene, and you know that this is actually all of our strategy, when it seems to me it's essentially timidity. But I think that there is that, that some people think that in the White House.
I would say though, that I mean, Egypt is really different from Libya, and Mubarak was an autocrat. Mubarak was repressive. There's no things, but Mubarak was also a very helpful stabilizing force, and certainly helpful in the relationship with Israel and the potential for peace talks moving forward. There's a lot of questions about, you know, who's going to help Abu Mazen and the Palestinian Authority move ahead now once Mubarak is gone. I mean, I have a certain amount of sympathy for their hesitancy on this. I've got no sympathy for their hand-wringing on Libya. I mean, Gaddafi is about as bad as it gets, and thankfully, one of the few good things that the George W. Bush administration did is they got his WMD out of there before he could build a nuclear weapon, and he did have all that stuff from AQ Khan. So there's no reason to hang on other than a fear of a political backlash or getting more deeply involved, or they don't have their act together, which is always seems to be. But the question also about not making it about the United States does seem like a legitimate question. In Iran during the Green Revolution, we felt that the Obama administration was right to hold back because of this long history of bad blood between the United States and Iran, and because the Iranian government is so willing to say any critic is a tool of the great Satan of the United States. So not making it about the United States seemed like the really right thing to do. Was that not the right choice in Egypt?
Well, I think the problem in Egypt was that we inadvertently sent signals that were perceived by Egyptians that we were not only engaged, but engaged on Mubarak's side.
Well, it was not signals. We said it explicitly a couple of times, Biden and
Frank Wisner.
Yeah.
I mean, the Frank Wisner mission was really just catastrophic. This was the former ambassador who went there and then publicly said that Mubarak was necessary for the stability of Egypt. Mubarak staying in office till September.
And Vice President Biden, of course, said that he wasn't a dictator.
Right. Secretary Clinton said at the beginning of the protests that something to the effect that nothing was going to become of them. I mean, we did manage to send these signals. And so you could see in Tahrir Square, day by day, they're becoming a little more resentment at what they perceived as the White House stiffing the population and supporting this, their thug. In the case of Bahrain, it kind of surprised me that there wasn't more sort of hostility or skepticism along those lines. The U.S. really didn't come up, even though we have the Fifth Fleet there, and even though we really have been supporting this, single family, this single Sunni family, the Al Khalifa family, that runs the country as a largely family show. And you had Shia protesters who were kind of asking the United States to be more supportive, but they did not take the next step and denounce the U.S. for supporting a repressive minority government.
And why do you think that is? Is it because they know Americans because the fleet is there, or?
You know, it's sort of interesting that in, I mean, frankly, in a lot of the Arab narrative over recent years, a lot of the conversation has been about outsiders and a lot of conspiracy theories, some true, some false, about the role of the U.S. or focus on Israel. And that has not been true this year of these protests. It really has not been. And I think in the case of Bahrain in particular, also there is a real concern amongst the protest leaders that they don't want, that they're afraid of scaring the West and afraid of scaring Saudi Arabia. And so they don't want to send a message that they're anti-American, anti-Fifth Fleet. But, you know, the, I mean, one of the things that really sometimes surprises me reporting in, especially in the Gulf, is just how much hostility there is among many Sunnis for the Shia population. And Bahrain, at the end of the day, really looks a little bit like apartheid South Africa. You've got 70% of the population is Shia, and they are not allowed, more or less, to join the police or the army. And you know, the notion that they could actually rule the country is just anathema.
And they believe the elections were stolen. I mean, they're so underrepresented in this last.
Right, and the if you look at the electoral districts, they're completely gerrymandered.
Sort of like New York State.
But it, you know, and that creates a real problem for the U.S. because we're, you know, we're support and the Bahrain government, to its credit, I mean, they have taken some steps toward democracy, toward tolerance, toward advancement of women's rights, and yet at the end of the day, it is this government that doesn't let 70% of the population join the security forces. And when I was there, they'd open fire on them.
So is it over in Bahrain, or what's?
I wish I knew. The gap between the two sides is so great. The Shia population essentially wants a democracy. They want a constitutional monarchy. I think they would accept something like Jordan or like Morocco, where the king has real rule rather than a British kind of constitutional monarchy, but still something that is fundamentally a democracy. And I think that it is very hard to imagine the royal family accepting anything close to that. And I guess my fear is that you will have a continuing series of paralyzing demonstrations, periodic skirmishes, and then at some point the harder line elements in the Bahraini regime will say, we tried negotiation, we tried to be soft, it didn't work, and then use force to clear the Pearl Roundabout, and maybe the way they would do that would be to open up the causeway to Saudi Arabia, bring in a bunch of Saudi thugs, and just, you know, use violence. That is my fear. We'll see.
Here's a question that was sent in on Facebook, which is about the role that Israel is playing. Of course, there's all these suggestions that Israel's on one side or the other side. The Israelis have been, to my mind, probably soundly quiet, and while very anxious about the departure of Mubarak, upon whom they depended as much as they railed against him. You know, is the best thing Israel can do keep its head down?
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, that as long as the conversation isn't about Israel, that should be good from Israel's point of view. And I just don't see how it can contribute in any way to what is going on.
And inside, you know, we've been talking to Israeli officials, and they seem to be the ones who don't want to negotiate with the Palestinians are using this as one more excuse not to negotiate. The people who do want to negotiate say that the window is closing. You can't depend on what a more democratic Egypt can do. This is the moment to strike and to push it. Do you have any sense at all of whether it's changing the politics inside of Israel?
I don't know. I do think that the Israeli concerns about where a more democratic Egypt might go you know, I think, but I'm not sure, are overblown. I interviewed a lot of people in Tahrir about that question of what a more democratic Egypt would be like vis-a-vis Israel. And what I always heard was that people, that they thought Mubarak was soft on Israel, and especially soft too hard on Gaza and Hamas. And so people strongly felt that Egypt should be somewhat tougher toward Israel and be much more conciliatory and helpful to the people of Gaza. On the other hand, if I ask people, you know, what about the peace treaty with Israel, and they did strongly believe that that should continue. And so they wanted continued peace with Israel.
Did they want it because it was financially in the interest of Egypt, or because they thought they didn't want another war, or what was the logic of it?
I think there was a strong pragmatic sense that to end the peace treaty would end, you know, U.S. support, would be devastating for their economy, might lead to a new war. But on the other hand, they were just troubled by all these images they've seen of Gaza. And so they felt that Egypt, as the leader of the Arab world, should be addressing Gaza more, but that they did not want to turn over the apple cart. I think that was basically the feeling. You know, on the other hand, though, we really don't know what Egyptians think. I mean, it's easy for me to go out in Tahrir and talk to the protesters, and I can go out in other places in, you know, in Cairo, but we really have no idea what villagers in rural Upper Egypt think, or rural villagers in the Delta think. There have been some opinion polls, but they've essentially been conducted in the cities. And there is just a lot of uncertainty about what your average Egyptian villager thinks about any of these issues.
Would your average Egyptian villager go to the polls in the fall?
I don't know. Again, one of the uncertainties.
So we get into final jeopardy here, which is prognostication time.
Uh-oh.
And we'll hold you to it because it's being taped.
You can just hit the delete button.
Right. I certainly would never have predicted, you know, that this would have happened in Egypt, even if you'd said to me 2 months ago. All of the things you talked about, demography and economics, all those things have been true for a very long period of time. Maybe the intervening variable is the internet, maybe the moon was right. You know, who would have expected it would have started in Tunisia and then inspired people? You know, if you had to imagine, if you were going to be making your travel budget out for the next few months, the next year or so, you know, what's next? And we're going to tap your other area of expertise to finish, which is to talk about how freaked the Chinese are about it.
Where does it go from here? You know, we're not close to coming up with the necessary and sufficient conditions for a revolution. But if you look at places that look wobbly, Sudan certainly fits into that realm. And in some of these countries, it might also be a coup d'etat rather than a popular uprising. But certainly northern Sudan is really traumatized by the loss of the southern half of the country. So Sudan would be a place to look at. Mauritania, hence my trip there, may be a place to look at. And there they have a real Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb problem. They have a real, it's somewhat close to being a failed state, and they have a real problem there. Morocco, I don't think, is probably as much of a risk, and I was impressed that the king kind of took credit for a protest there rather than suppressing them. It said, oh, you know, this is a reflection of how democratic we are, which I thought was a really shrewd approach. I guess my hunch is that Saudi Arabia will pull through and that in general the Gulf countries will. I mean, I think the same pressures are building in Saudi Arabia, but my hunch is that they will be able to defuse them, except maybe in Saudi Arabia in the eastern province with Shiites there.
An awful lot of money floating around in that eastern province, though.
That's right. That's right. And that could get pretty bubbly. Iran, Iran, who knows? I tend to think that, and my view is here is shaped a lot by my China-watching years, that that one of the fallacies that we make in looking at democratic uprisings is we think that they occur when people are most upset. And in fact, in general, they occur when people think they can get away with it. And the correlation is not when people are most...
The revolution of rising expectations.
That when they're, you know, that crackdowns work. If the best predictor of whether a crackdown is going to be successful is whether an army is willing to open fire on people. And when it does, then, you know, then usually a crackdown succeeds. That's why Mubarak is out of power, because his army wouldn't shoot people. And same with Tunisia, with Ben Ali in Tunisia. I don't know about Iran. I'd wonder about that. China. There's clearly a lot of discontent in China. It's not so much economic discontent, although I think, you know, people can get amazingly used to 10% annual economic growth rates. And there was a study recently by the Academy of Social Sciences that found that discontent was at its highest level in 11 years. Everybody you talk to is upset by corruption, for example.
And they also have inflation.
And they have inflation now. And people, and maybe the best indicator that there might be a problem there is that the government is, as you say, completely freaked out by what is happening. And you know, in the Weibo, which is the Chinese version of Twitter, you cannot search any kinds of term. You can't search Egypt. You can't search any of these countries. And when they've had these floating demonstrations announced on Twitter, then the state security and public security just go in really with a phenomenal degree of presence. And the way they've gone after reporters lately and threatened reporters is something that we haven't seen since about 1990 or so, in the immediate aftermath of Tiananmen. So I think the government feels there is something there. It's hard for me to know how right that is. But it seems to me, I guess, at the end of the day, that probably people in Beijing and Shanghai are pretty scared, and it'd be hard to see something happening there. In some of the other towns and cities, people, I think, are a little less frightened, and one can imagine some kind of protest arising in those places. But it's always hard to, I mean, I always wonder if maybe the incident that would tip off anti-government protests in China would be not something economic or political, but something anti-Japanese, a sense that a nationalist protest against something done by Japan to China, a sense that the Chinese government wasn't standing up for itself. It's I think, very hard to predict what happens. But if I were a Chinese leader, I think I'd be a little concerned too.
And we'll be able to read it when it happens. It'll be very interesting to see what the Chinese vote, if they vote in the Security Council on Libya. So stability seems to be their number one goal, but which way they assess it. So Nick, thank you so much. This was great. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.